So if you talk about WSO2, WSO2 is an open source software company which is specialized in developing middleware application related to the integration domain. WSO2 has around 550 employees, including 300 engineers, and this is a completely open source company founded in 2005 backed by Cisco and Toba Capital. And currently we have around 500 customers where we got 175 in last year. We have around 37 million subscription revenue and 50% year-to-year growth. Currently we have offices in Colombo, New York, London, Mountain View, Sao Paulo, Sydney, and Berlin. Our main engineering division is currently located in Colombo. So without further ado, let's move into the topic. So before going into directly about the CCPA, let me give little facts about the state of California, because the CCPA is directly affecting the state of California. So around there are nearly 40 million people lives in California, which is about 12% of the US population. That is more than people live in Canada. And California's economy is also outsized at around $2.7 trillion. So if you think that California were a country, it would be the fifth largest economy in the world, beating out the UK. So California is a marketplace that many brands inside and outside the US just can't ignore. They will have no choice but to comply with the Consumer Privacy Act. That said, compliance should be relatively easy for brands that are already in compliance with GDPR. Let's talk about what is CCPA. So as mentioned in the bill, it is a bill that enhances privacy rights and consumer protection for residents of California, and it applies to any businesses that collects consumers' personal data which does business in California. But as opposed to the GDPR, this has few criteria that should match to get the effect of CCPA, which are a company should has annual gross revenue in excess of $25 million, and possess the personal information of 50,000 or more consumers, house earns more than half of its annual revenue from selling consumers' personal information. So let's talk about when this will be get effected. The bill was passed by California State Legislature into the law by the governor of California on June 28, 2018. But the CCPA will become effective on January 1st, 2020. So it has given around like 2 years to other organizations to prepare. And we have now less than 1 year to prepare for that. So then let's talk why this CCPA is affecting. So according to the current law in the United States, it does not fully cover the consumer privacy into a much extent. So with the CCPA, the consumer will get the following benefits. So they will have the right to know what info that large corporations are collecting about, and they will have the right to tell a business not to share or sell any their personal information, and they will have the right to protection against businesses which do not uphold the value of their privacy. So so these three objectives are divided into another 10 sub objectives. So let's talk about them. So these are the objectives of CCPA. So the first objective is right to know all data collected by a business on you twice a year free of charge. So basically that means, so if an organization collects your personal information, then that user has an ability to see what are those data, how they are collected and how they are stored free of charge. And they have right to say no to the sale of their information. So let's talk about the current way. So for example, let's say if you go to the Google and you search for something, and then you go using that same email address, if you log into the Facebook, you will see that that they are showing advertisements according to your search. So that's like selling your information. So with CCPA, you have right to say not to not for that. And the CCPA has a separate section about information security, that how your data should be stored and processed. And the another one important thing is right to delete your data. So basically, if you have any account with your personal information, you have a right to ask that corporation to delete all of your information without keeping any recorded. And another special, so these objectives are a little bit similar with the GDPR, but there are some certain differences as well. So in later on, we will do a comparison as well to find what are the differences. So the other thing is right not to be discriminated against if you tell a company not to sell your personal information. So this means depending on your ethnicity or your religion or any kind of thing, the companies cannot discriminate about selling your personal information. Next one is right to be informed of what categories of data will be collected about you prior to its collection at the point of collection, and to be informed of any changes to this collection. So that means, so let's say if you are logging into a certain website, if that website collects your information, let's say your email address, your first name, your last name, that should be clearly mentioned that they are collecting this information, and it should say why they are collecting it and what are they are going to use that information. Then mandate opt-in before sale of children's information. So according to the CCPA, children's under age of 16 are registered under guardian or their parents. So they have ability to opt-in before sale of that children's information. Next thing is right to know the categories of the third parties with whom your data is shared. So as I told in the early example about the Google, so if some website sells your information to third party, then that should be clearly mentioned. Right to know categories of sources of information from whom your data was acquired. So that comes to that comes when come to the third party. So if your third party application gets some information about you, the third party application should inform from where that they get those information. And the last one is right to know the business or commercial purpose of collecting your information. As I said earlier, so when they're collecting, some company or website is collecting your information, there should be a clear way to inform that why they are collecting this information. So let's talk about the impact of the CCPA. So currently, there isn't any law that if some data breaches happens, and let's say our data is collected by some thief or some organization that we don't want to, from CCPA, there are laws that we can charged against those companies who are victims of data breach, so we can like get the remedies for them. And there is a fine up to $7,500 for each intentional violation and $2,500 for each unintentional violations. Okay, so as I said earlier, let's compare the CCPA against GDPR, because GDPR is already there. So by comparing GDPR with CCPA, we can get some understanding what should we do. So to compare CCPA versus GDPR, let's divide into three subcategories. So we are going to compare it according to the personal data, data subjects, and privacy rights. So according to the CCPA, a personal data is information that identifies, relates to, describes, is capable of being associated with, or could reasonably link directly or indirectly with a particular consumer or household. But according to the GDPR, any information relating to an identified or identifiable natural person, directly or indirectly, in particular by reference to an identifier such as name, an identification number, location data, an online identifier, or more factors specified to the physical, psychological, genetic, mental, economic, cultural, or social identity of that natural person. So the main difference of personal data is that CCPA defines it can be consumer or household, but in GDPR, it is any information that can be used to identify a natural person. So again, the next one is the data subjects. So in CCPA, any individual who is in California for other than a temporary or transitory purpose, and any individual who is domiciled in California who is outside the state of a temporary or transitive purpose is a data subject. In the GDPR, any identified or identified natural person to which the personal data relates. So basically, the difference is more or same, but the CCPA defines it strictly that any data that is related to the state of California is a data subject, but the GDPR is, it's again for the European Union. And the, if we compare basic privacy rights, so those are much similar with CCPA and GDPR, but in CCPA, it has so right to request disclosure, right to request deletion, right of access and data portability, right to opt out, right not to be discriminated as the main privacy rights. So basically right to request disclosure is similar as right to be informed in GDPR. Right to request deletion is again in GDPR, it has the right to erasure, right to be forgotten. And right of access and data portability is that it is also available in GDPR, said that the user should be able to download their data whenever they want. So right to opt out is also there in GDPR. And the difference is right not to be discriminated in, it is not available in the GDPR, but it's available in the CCPA. The others are a little bit similar. Okay, so let's move into our next topic, the enterprise and the CCPA. So basically in here, like to discuss how the enterprise should adapt to the CCPA. So basically, first you need to understand whether you are affected by this. So to do that, so we can categorize our businesses in three zones. So let's say if your business is in California and you do business with California, so that's that will be affected from the CCPA. And let's say your business is outside from the California, but you still do your business with California, then you are also affected. But the other category. That means if your business is in California, but you do not do business with California, then you are not affected. But again, even though CCPS allow you to opt out feature, it's always good to go for the like the maximum standard. So basically, then it will make easy for you to do the businesses. So for the preparation, let's divide that into two categories. So for the preparation, first you need to plan about your data. So later on we will discuss what is this, and you have to plan your process. So by data planning, I mean, so you have to reconsider whether you want to use the third party data. So basically, so let's say now you have a business, you collect, you use single sign-on to log into your website. So if you use something similar technology called OAuth or OpenID Connect, you have the capability to request certain data from third party application. But now, before CCPA, you have to plan whether you need these data actually. Because if you are taking any unwanted data, then you will be, either you have to explain to the user why are you going to use this data, or else you will be penalized. The next thing is you have to re-evaluate the data fields in your forms and profiles. So let's say this is not the simple SSO scenario. You are the one who collects your information. Let's say you have a registration field. And in those registration fields, if you are collecting unnecessary data for your application, then you have to remove those fields and you have to make it clear. So again, that means you have only collect data that you have a clear and immediate use. For example, if you are creating a web application for call management, you will be needing telephone numbers. That's okay to collect, but then you have to explain why you are collecting them. But if you are collecting like their last name, their name, so those will be not needed for you. So you have to remove those kind of information. So that's go with the data planning. In the process planning, so in the process planning, so in the CCPA, so there are certain processes that they are expecting the business to do. So for example, there should be ability that your collected information that the user should be able to download those information. And there are opt-out features. They need to modify those information. So they need to completely delete those information. So basically, if you do currently do not have those kind of mechanisms in your web application, then you have to create a way to give those functionalities. So otherwise, you will be like penalized. So So as I discussed the process planning, so let's move on to the role of IAM. So where I can explain, so how IAM can help for the mechanisms that I explained in the previous section. For example, how IAM can help you in data planning and how IAM can help you in process planning. So so in here also, I have divided this into three sections. So basically, these are the main sections that affect in the CCPA: the consent management, data processing, and the identity governance. So let's move into the first thing. So like in GDPR, CCPA requires user consent always. For example, if you are going to keep user information, first you need to get the consent of that user before you are going to keep those information. And consent management features, other consent management features are that including the profile management, change of consent, and revocation. For example, later on, so maybe as on I said in data management, you only need to keep the immediate data. But later on, you added, let's say in your web application, later on you added some different functionality that need different kind set of data. So on that time, you can request that those information. But again, you have to re-request the consent from that user. So that, that's what consent management. And later on, let's say that user decided to delete your information, then again you need to have a facility to revoke that consent and those kind of things. The next thing is the data processing. So again, CCPA and GDPR is as well strictly tells how the data processing should be handled. So basically, security of the data processing is a one mandatory thing. So basically, all of your data that should be encrypted and stored, because otherwise there can be security thefts and your data will be released. So according to the CCPA, that's an offense. Another one is the pseudonymization. So what pseudonymization means is, let's say let's say all web applications like that, they keep the records of the events that happening in the web application. For example, let's say a certain user logs into a web application. We log those information. We keep audit logs, and we are keeping those information in certain areas. We may be passing in messages and those kind of things. So whenever a user requests to delete their information, we have to make sure that we delete all those locations with that user information. So even in GDPR, the right to erasure, it mentioned that if a certain user asks to delete, we cannot keep any information in our system. That includes logs as well. So in the pseudonymization, what we do is, instead of having the user's direct personal information, we use a pseudonym to that. So even after a deletion, we can keep track what are the events that user did, but we cannot track who did that events. So that's what pseudonymization means. So IAM product supports that. And the next major thing is authentication, authorization, and access management. So that is a must needed thing, basically. So the authentication and authorization is there for the security measures, and access management can be used to delegate certain level of access management to reduce the amount of data that will be exposed to the outside. And the next thing is the data minimization. So as I talked in the previous section, you should not hold no more data than you need. And so using an IAM system, so you can keep your data in a central position. So manage them using the IAM. So basically, you can decide what are the user profiles, what are the data that you need, how a user profile will be. For example, let's say you are using LDAP management. So LDAP, you can have what are the attributes that should keep for the user, such and such things. And the next important thing, so this is is more related to the data security. So basically, by data partitioning, you can like have a certain set of data in a different location. So breaches can be minimized using that. Then the next important thing is the identity governance. So identity governance is used to like, using the access control, you can have the visibility levels. For example, let's say in your company, let's say there are like system administrators, which should only see the personal information of the user, not the other group. So basically, you can divide your organization into certain levels and give the access control according to that. And if that is also not enough, we can go for the fine-grained access control with the security policies. For example, there are like only at the certain time of the day you can view the certain person's information, and only data backing up is only happening in certain time. So those can be written using the fine grain access control. And the next thing is workflows. So let's say without giving a one person the complete access, you can have a set of workflows. For example, so some data to be processed, then it should be approved by a certain higher level of authority before it is processed. Okay, so coming at to the end, so we have to think about what's next there to be. So basically, now there are less than a year to prepare. So you need to use tools and practices already available to minimize the risks. So basically, since GDPR is already there are a certain level of utilities applications. For example, WSO2, we provide WSO2 identity server with full stack of IAM tools that support CCPA as well. And you can use those standards and practices to minimize the risk. And as mentioned in the CCPA legislation, there are like certain loopholes currently there. So CCPA will evolve certainly, and there will be more amendments. So we have to get ready for those as well. So that's the end of my webinar. So thank you for that listening. So if you have questions now, you can point. So okay, so we have one question. What are the offerings of WSO2 related to the CCPA? So yeah, so as I mentioned earlier, so WSO2 provide WSO2 identity server, so which has a different set of privacy toolkit, which has all the capabilities. So in the WSO2 identity server also, it has inbuilt capabilities of like consent management, workflows, as I mentioned, fine-grained access control, those kind of things. And we have different privacy toolkit that is used for the, for example, right to erasure, the pseudonymization, and those kind of things. Okay, so I have another question. How are we gonna remove the username from the WSO2 logs when the user did account deletion? Yeah, so it's also related to the first question. As I said, we have a separate toolkit called WSO2 Privacy Toolkit. In that toolkit, we can like whenever user request the erasure, using that toolkit, we can remove all the that username information, including the logs, like audit logs, debug logs, and all the information. So that toolkit has that capability. Okay, so there's another question. Do any information as part of application and insurability subject to the CCPA when we don't sell any information but just keep it as part of application? Yes, so CCPA says that when whatever information that you collect, you have to get the consent for that. Even though you are not going to sell it or you are not going to give it to third party, you have to get the user consent, specifically saying what is the, what is those information are used for. Okay, so I think those are the questions. So thank you for listening. Have a good day.